Our world is an amazing, complex living organism, and we coexist in a symbiotic relationship. With this great power comes great responsibility, a responsibility to ensure the future by taking steps to be sustainable today. Sustainable Today is being made possible in part by Greenhammer Building Contractors in Portland, Oregon. Endura Wood Products. Fine wood products for today and tomorrow in Portland, Oregon. And the Black Point Inn in Oregon City, Oregon.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us again on Sustainable Today. We're so glad you could join us. This is the show that helps you become more sustainable both at home and at work. This evening, the show is going to be about organic food. I'm Darcy Hitchcock.
And I'm Marcia Willard.
Marcia, tell us a little bit about what we have planned.
Well, we're going to take you inside the organic food industry and show you how it's done. And you'll get to see why buying organic food is one of the best ways to be sustainable today.
And today we have on the show with us Chris Schreiner, who's Quality Control Director from Oregon Tilth. Thanks, Chris, for being on the show with us.
Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Well, Chris, we're looking forward to hearing what you have to tell us a little later in the show. But first, Darcy and I are going to cover some news stories of things we've discovered this month about sustainability around the world.
Absolutely. Well, we always have something about climate change that's been so much in the news. And I saw in the New York Times a story about Climate Counts, which has released a scorecard now that compares different consumer companies. For example, you can compare Coke versus Pepsi or Stonyfield versus Sara Lee and see the difference between these two companies. And the coolest part is you can, if you have a cell phone that can do this, you can be standing there in the aisle and call up their website and choose which product you want from the company that has the better climate performance.
Oh, that's gonna make things competitive, isn't it?
I certainly think so. Yeah. And I think it will also encourage companies, I think, to release more information about their performance, because some of the companies may not have scored well just because the information wasn't available, or so they say.
Right, and so now I can see it being suspicious if a company doesn't post the information, and I, as the consumer, want to know.
Yeah, that's absolutely. Cool. So what about you?
Well, I encountered something really interesting in an Australian newspaper about a city in Sweden. I'm not going to try and pronounce it. It's spelled V-A-X-J-O.
I'm not
so
going to try
go
either.
There.
No, I'm not going to try either.
But the thing that was so eye-catching is that they are trying to eliminate fossil fuels from the city, from the whole city, and they are already about halfway to becoming climate neutral.
How is that even possible with such a cold climate?
Well, they're doing some very creative things. A lot of their electricity was traditionally done or produced by coal, and so they're phasing out the coal and instead burning wood waste from the forest products that they're taking out. So there's a little less carbon in that. And also they're collecting garbage from in the municipality and using it to create biofuels, biogas.
Like methane or
yeah,
that sort of thing.
And running automobiles on that. They're trying to phase out gasoline in the city.
That is just amazing. It's so helpful to hear stories like that because it shows people that it's just not a matter of, oh, a little bit less, a little bit less. We can make radical improvements and not affect our quality of life.
Not affect the quality of life. And the other interesting thing about the story is it's not hurting the economy. They're doing just fine, thank you very much, in spite of all the predictions to the contrary.
Oh, that's so inspiring.
Yeah. So you too can do this.
Really?
The other thing I saw was, I saw this in a couple of newspapers, both the Oregonian and USA Today, a couple of articles about the declining bird population. And birds, a wide spectrum of bird species. They said that 20 common American birds have declined by more than half over the last 40 years.
That's during our lifetime. Not to publicize that too much.
Lifetime and a little bit more.
Yeah, well, let's not emphasize that.
It was interesting because people think about the eagles, and if you've been watching the news, the eagles have been just removed from the endangered species list, which is good news. But, you know, it takes the spotlight off all these other birds. And the thing about the eagles is that they were mostly affected by DDT, the pesticide, which we banned, I think, about 40 years ago. And so their populations have been increasing. But these birds, these more generic common birds that we're so familiar seeing, are being impacted mostly by habitat loss.
So as we expand our cities and you know, chew up a little more land for agriculture,
and as climate change changes their habitat too.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, the other story I came across that relates to pesticides and all of that is that the EPA has been required for quite some time now to test certain chemicals for endocrine disruptors. Those are the ones that mimic hormones, and they were supposed to have started doing this by 2002. Well, the news is that they're just now getting ready to agreeing to test 73 pesticides.
73? Well,
that's better than nothing.
I'm sorry,
you know?
I laughed.
Let's not be too critical here. But what might be interesting is how this might force changes in agricultural practices now that they're going to start testing them.
We'll ask Gargesk about that a little bit later.
Yeah. So, you know, there's still like 100,000 different chemicals that we're using. So the 73 is just the beginning of it. But at least now we have a test. That was part of the complication, was that they didn't have a test to find out whether something was an endocrine disruptor or not.
Well, similarly, I found a story about the EPA is now coming down on particle board and plywood mills, you know, the composite wood products that are made. They release formaldehyde and methanol into the atmosphere because of the products, you know, the things
or
they use to make
homes,
it.
In your home,
that's right.
Yes.
They off-gas after they're in your home. But even at the mills, we released, just in Oregon, almost 3 million pounds of this stuff. And these are carcinogens. And it makes me think about the products that are formaldehyde-free.
Right.
That finally might have an edge.
Well, maybe that'll help. Well, let's pull Chris into the conversation now. So, Chris,
thanks so much for being on the show.
So tell us just a little bit about Oregon Tilth and what it does.
Sure. Oregon Tilth is a nonprofit organization that we promote and support biologically sound and socially equitable agriculture. And we do this through education, research, advocacy, and product certification. We're probably best known for our organic certification program, where we certify farmers, handlers, and processors of organic food. But we also publish a magazine, In Good Tilth. We publish that 6 times a year, and it's full of great information about sustainable food systems, and we mail that to all our members and bulk distribute it through natural food stores throughout the Pacific Northwest. And we also have an organic education center. It's located at the historic Lusher Farm in Lake Oswego, and there we have a demonstration garden, we have classes and workshops, bring school kids out, and really try to teach people about organic gardening and sustainable food systems.
That's
very, very
cool.
Fun. Yeah. Well, this is an interesting topic, food, because we all need it. And what I believe is a lot of us don't really know where our food comes from. But one of the things that I've been hearing in the news for many years, you know, thanks to Willie Nelson and a few other, you know, the farm aid thing, is about the demise of the small farmer and the growth of the mega agricultural industry. And so what does that mean? What is the impact on us as consumers of that trend?
Yeah, I think there's a couple impacts. One is less diversity, and kind of a corresponding one is more concentration and consolidation. So these large farms, they adopt models of industrialization and specialization. So they really grow monoculture cropping systems, the same crop over acres and acres of land. And this same model of industrialization gets passed on in the food system. So we see consolidation, concentration of food handling and distribution. And this can become a liability. Think about the E. coli spinach outbreak we saw.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that. You know, if everybody had their own little spinach patch, it wouldn't have been such a dramatic problem.
That's right, but we had one valley in California, but an impact over many brands and many parts of the of the U.S. And so that's some of the consequences that we have from this industrialized food system.
And it also implies that food is traveling, obviously, a great distance if people on the East Coast are eating California-grown spinach.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, one of the benefits that we could call of these economies of scale is cheap food, but this cheap food doesn't take into consideration consideration these externalized costs, these impacts on the environment, on our health, and mm-hmm. also the high energy use that it takes to support these industrialized food systems.
That's interesting. That's mm-hmm.
Well, it sure seems that there's more and more interest that in the general public about food and where it's coming from. You know, the farmers markets are very popular yeah. these days, and mm-hmm. the slow food movement and that sort of thing. So what do you think's leading to this interest in the public?
Yeah, I think there's a couple factors going on. One is, you know, this is an information age, and knowledge is power, and we have access to more information than we've really ever had before. And to me, this is helping us realize that we're not passive participants in the marketplace. We can be active players, and if we know about the products we're purchasing, we can use our dollars to support things that support our values. Mm-hmm. So that's one factor. The other one is we're in an age of global economies and extended food systems. And so, like you were saying, Marcia,
all the China problems.
Yeah,
oh my gosh.
Average food travels 1,200 to 1,500 miles from farm to plate.
And is it losing nutrition wow. all along the way?
Well, there's studies about that, but I think one of the consequences of these long food chains is a real anonymity between the person who grew the food and the person that's eating it. And so I think that this return and this desire to reconnect to food is really an effort to get people closer to their food, to have a more authentic and direct experience and know the story behind their food.
So. Yeah, it's mm-hmm. interesting because, you know, I grew up thinking food came wrapped in plastic.
Yeah.
We really are disconnected from the earth that it came
yeah,
in.
Yeah, yeah,
that whole
yeah.
process.
It's starting to change. There's some good signs out there in the marketplace.
Mm-hmm, yep. mm-hmm. Well, I have a couple of questions about terms that I've been hearing that are, you know, kind of, or produce mumbo jumbo, I'm not sure what they mean, like GMO, and I've heard the term terminator seed,
yeah.
which sounds, you know, kind of Schwarzenegger-ish. What does that mean? What do those things mean?
Yeah, well, let's start with GMO. GMO stands for genetically modified organism. I prefer the term genetically engineered organism because I think it's a little more scientifically accurate. But basically what these are life forms, plants, animals, bacteria, that have had their genes altered because DNA from a completely different organism has been inserted into mm-hmm. them. So instead of using traditional breeding or cross-pollination techniques, scientists today are using these new technologies, recombinant DNA technologies, gene splicing, gene doubling, cloning, to make combinations of organisms that were before never possible in nature.
Interesting. Well, that sounds pretty clever. And I understand that in some cases they can design in resistance to certain pests and things like that?
Yeah,
is this a cool thing?
Well, we have some concerns with this technology. It's unprecedented. As I said, it's never happened before, and we're crossing species barriers. I mean, we're inserting animal genes into plants, and some of the long-term impacts on the environment and what happens as these new genes spread into the environment is really a big unknown. So it's a big experiment, and we're not so sure that it's the kind of experiment we need to be doing with our food.
This seems like it would especially be an issue with wind-pollinated crops, where, you know, corn, for example, and things like that.
Yeah.
I remember reading a wonderful passage that Barbara Kingsolver wrote in, what was it, Small Wonder, Small Wonders, that book. She did a beautiful job of describing some of the problems associated with GMO. And one of the points that I remember her making is that genes don't do one thing, and how they express themselves and how they operate is actually very complicated, so we really have no idea what we're doing when we do this.
There's a lot of unknowns, and I think that the precautionary principle should really be applied when we're trying these new technologies out. If we've got time, the terminator seed yeah. technology, that's a product of genetic engineering, and what it is it results in plants that produce sterile seeds. Basically, this is a strategy from seed companies to protect the patents on novel plants that they've developed.
Oh my gosh, interesting.
So traditionally,
interesting business model.
Yeah, traditionally, growers and gardeners have been able to plant seed, raise the plant, and harvest that seed and plant it next year for themselves. But now with this terminator technology, that next generation of seed is completely sterile, so you're always
wow.
going back to the seed company to buy it. That
Ooh,
seed, if you want to grow that plant.
It's kind of like designing in extinction if we're not careful.
It is, and it takes away our food sovereignty to a certain degree.
Interesting. Mm-hmm.
And there have been lawsuits, right, about companies being upset that somehow something else has been affected by their their seed and so forth, their pollen. It's very, it's very.
And when you have an organic farm next to one of these kinds of farms,
causes problems. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, speaking of seed, we have a wonderful story to show you. Organic certification now requires that crops grown from organic now be grown from organic seed. Before, organic growers could use any commercially available seed, whether it came from an organic source or not. Now that seed must be organic too, and there's no real open market for seed suppliers. One grower, Frank Morton of the Wild Garden Seed Company, has joined with the Organic Seed Alliance and OSU to develop a market. The Seed Alliance, according to Frank, is the first such organization in the nation between farmers, horticulturalists, and researchers to produce an organic seed supply. Katie Wood takes us to one of the first organic seed producers to get an update.
Today we are talking with Frank Morton from the Organic Seed Alliance, and he's on the board of directors, and here we are standing on Gathering Together Farms in Philomath, Oregon. Hi Frank, how are you doing today?
Thank you, Katie. Nice to have you here.
Yeah, it's great to be here. So the Organic Seed Alliance, what is the Organic Seed Alliance exactly?
Organic Seed Alliance is a nonprofit group that's working to essentially conserve our genetic resources for use by farmers. And we do this through an alliance of farmers, university scientists, and seed industry people that have an interest in providing quality organic seed to organic farmers. This is a parsley seed crop. We're growing this for seed. We'll sell it to seed companies and through our catalog. But it also, while this is in this stage, it's blooming right now, it's flowering, and you can see all these little insects that are attracted to these blossoms. Here's a syrphid fly right here. Syrphid flies eat aphids. There are honeybees and solitary native bees on this. There's a ladybug right there, I saw a ladybug larva just a moment ago. So these parsley plants are a very good source for what beneficial insects need to complete their life cycles. Insects need nectar to give them the energy to fly around, and they need pollen to give them the protein that they need to lay eggs. And so some of the insects that are visiting these flowers, these parsley flowers, are collecting pollen. They will eat that pollen and they will fly directly to a plant that has aphids on it. They'll know it by its smell, and they will lay their eggs on that aphid-infested plant. But they need the pollen from these flowers in order to complete that life cycle. So while we're growing seeds as an economic enterprise for this farm, look at everything happening right here. We're also providing a pest control benefit for Gathering Together Farm as we are producing seeds.
So this is your breeding ground, right? For seeds, this for the lettuce?
We're standing right in the middle of a little breeding plot of mine. We're actually surrounded by my seed production field. It's about, this is about 2.5 acres. And in this one little section of it where we're standing is a place where I have a small breeding plot where I am looking at types of lettuce that I've recently developed, and I'm seeing how they grow in an actual field situation here, as opposed to in my breeding nursery. And these lettuces, you're standing between two rows of one variety that's a super dark red oak leaf that does not get this disease called downy mildew. Downy mildew, if it were here, would be making these leaves very spotted. This variety right here seems to be completely resistant to it. None of this stuff has got a name yet. The lettuce, they have different uses. You know, some of them are for making heads of lettuce like this. Others are for making salad greens where the lettuce plants are just allowed to grow small and then cut that way. Others will make a head more like an iceberg lettuce. But what they all have in common is that these plants were bred from the ground up within an organic system with the idea, with the goal of creating a lettuce that performs better for organic growers who don't use chemicals to protect against disease. This will give them a better, healthier crop, and because it's new to the market, it has a different appearance than what's in the market now. And so it will give organic growers actually something unique and novel and never seen before. This is a project that was actually inspired by farmer John Evelyn, who one day commented as Organic Seed Alliance people were sitting around my table. John Evelyn says, well, you know what I want is I want a sugary enhanced sweet corn that has good cold soil emergence early in the season so that I can get my, so that I can have early corn on the market. And there is no such corn. Sugary enhanced corn, which is what he was referring to, is not good at emerging from cold soil. It tends to be attacked by soil organisms before it can grow through the soil if you try to plant it early in the spring to get a good early crop. So, on John's suggestion, me and John Navazio at Organic Seed Alliance started this project on our own time around year 2001. John Navazio got some corn from the corn breeding department at Wisconsin State. The head of that department is on our board of directors. His name's Bill Tracy, and he provided us with some corn to start with that he had been working on in Wisconsin. And Jim Myers is giving us that sophistication in plant breeding and showing us how to judge the tenderness of the corn while still collecting seed off of the very same ear that you're tasting. John Evelyn, the farmer who suggested the project in the first place, is going to be the corn taster. And at some point in July, me and John and Michaela Cawley of Organic Seed Alliance are going to go down these rows, and John is going to bite the ears and rate it for us on tenderness, and Michaela and I are going to mark the ones that John approves of, and those will be saved special for replanting next year. And so at that point, we should have a corn that is cold soil emergent, has good competition with weeds, is early in the season, has the tenderness that John needs at his markets, and we'll be well on our way toward having an organic corn, especially for the Willamette Valley, and that's what we want to do. And I am trying to encourage farmers to essentially pick up on the selection process right then and make their final selection on their organic farm. Then that lettuce or that kale or whatever it is will better suit their place if they do the final three selections than if I do it. Organic farmers seem to be very hungry for this knowledge. The seed industry has always been an extremely secretive industry, essentially in hopes of having some sort of a monopoly on the seed supply. We don't think that's a very good idea. We believe in openness regarding seeds and in sharing information regarding seeds, how to do the breeding, what plant varieties make excellent parents. We want to spread this information, not keep it to ourselves. And that makes us a little different than the industry as a whole. But what we're trying to do in this whole process is to create what would essentially be an open source system of seed, where the final products are actually developed in a community effort. It's no one individual doing all the work. It's community work. And when the work is done, it belongs to everybody. The problem with the public domain is that in seeds, we have seen over and over things that are put into the public domain today can later be tweaked the smallest amount by the seed industry and then claimed as their product, shutting us out of further development of that variety. This concept of open source seeds, anybody can use it. Anybody can use it to create new varieties. Anybody can grow it and sell it.
We just saw earlier at the farm about the pod of the mustard seed. How do you separate the seed from the pod and really just get it down to the final product?
Well, after threshing the plants in the field, it looks something like this. This would be mustard seed, and it's a mixture of the seed pod and the seed. And so always when we're, it's very low tech, always when we're cleaning seeds, it's an alternation between using the wind to winnow and using a screen to separate things by size. And the size separation part is as simple as pouring the seed through a screen, and this can be a screen that you make yourself, just like this one. And this becomes compost. And you're left with a mixture of small chaff and seeds.
A little bit of it all in there.
Mm-hmm. And if even with just a little natural wind, and very little practice, you can separate the chaff from the seed.
So this is it, huh? The final product of, I mean, this is the seed. This is it.
That's what it's all about. And that's what OSA is all about. The ethical stewardship of the seed resource.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Frank, for talking to me today. I really appreciate it. I had a great time on the farm and everything.
Good.
Hope
Thanks.
To see you again. Definitely.
Thank you.
And I'm Katie Wood, bringing you the tools to make you more sustainable today.
Tell us a little bit more about organic. What does it mean? What does a farm have to do to be able to live up to that label?
Yeah, well, organic farming is a holistic approach to farming. It really strives to work in balance with nature rather than to try to control it. So what that means is it's very site-specific. They use mechanical, biological, cultural practices, and they use these practices to foster the cycling of resources, to promote ecological balance and conserve biodiversity.
Can you give a specific example? That was a lot of conceptual.
Sure, yeah. You know, cycling of resources, it might be planting a cover crop and tilling that crop into the soil to return some nutrients and nitrogen to the soil. You know, promoting ecological balance means growing a diversity of crops instead of those monocultures to have a checks and balances of the natural systems in place.
Mm-hmm.
In the marketplace, organic now is a federally defined term, and it's set in regulations by the USDA, so anyone that wants to use that label on their products has to meet some specific standards.
Okay.
And as you asked, farms and ranches that want to use that organic label have to get certified organic by a third-party organization like Oregon Tilth.
Like Oregon Tilth?
Yeah. And that process basically begins with the farm providing us with an organic farm management plan. This tells us everything about the farm, what they're doing for fertility, how they're managing pests, what steps they've taken to avoid contamination from any adjacent land practices that might not be organic.
Okay.
And then after we've got that plan, we'll send an inspector out to the farm, and the inspector's job is really just to make sure that what's happening in the field is an accurate reflection of what's written in the plan, so that there's some trust and confidence behind that label. And once they're certified, our farmers, they have to provide us annual updates to their farms, plans, and they get annually inspected each year. So there's ongoing monitoring, and that's what really gives the consumer the confidence and trust behind that label.
We're working with a winery right now, and they were talking about it can take 3 years. And so what's the three-year cycle?
Good question. Yeah, under the organic standards, acreage can't produce an organic crop until it's been free from any prohibited materials for at least a 36-month period of time,
okay,
so 3 years.
To let it sort of cleanse out of the soil.
Yeah.
And is it the same as sustainable? Like, I know the Food Alliance makes a distinction between organic and what they certify. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, today, you know, as I said, organic is really about how the food was grown. When I think about a sustainable food system, there are other factors that come into play besides how it's grown. Of course, that's an important piece, but there's other issues like where was it grown, how much energy was used to grow it, how were the farm workers treated.
Yeah.
These kinds of issues are part of our bigger sustainable food system in our bigger sustainable food picture. So I'd say that organic and sustainable aren't the same thing, but organic's a great first step on that path toward a sustainable food system.
Okay, so an organic labeling says nothing about labor practices or those kinds
of things. Right, exactly, right. And Food Alliance do have some farm worker standards built into their practices.
I see. Yeah. Well, even without that extra bit of requirement, organic food is more expensive. Mm-hmm. And we've been talking to some folks in preparation for our next month's show about hunger, and you know, it puts people who are on low income in a bind, and it's harder for them to get good, healthy food.
Mm-hmm.
Why is organic more expensive?
Well, I'll tell you, to be honest, I think that the attitude that organic food is too expensive is really a disservice to the sustainable food movement. And the reason is because the cheap food that we've been talking about earlier, that from the industrialized food system, doesn't take into consideration those externalized costs. So, you know, the money we're saving on cheap food, we're paying for in these other areas of environmental impacts, health costs, energy use. So, you know, granted, access to safe and healthy food is an issue that this society has to address, but I don't think that the long-term solution to that problem is trying to make our food cheaper. You know, it's a tough issue, but one thing that Oregon Tilth does to help provide safe and healthy food to less, people with lower incomes, is we donate the food from our demonstration garden at the Organic Education Center. So last year alone, we grew over 2,000 pounds of fresh organic produce that went to emergency food shelters throughout the Portland metro area.
We'll be interviewing one of the recipients, I think, next month.
But
on a similar note, I've also heard it said that if the whole world were organic, if all the farms on the planet were organic, we wouldn't be able to produce enough food for the world because yields tend to be lower on an organic farm. So is that true? And so what does that imply for the future?
Yeah, that's a good question, and it's an important question. You know, in some crops, it's true that organic yields aren't as high as the non-organic system, but in other crops, they're actually quite comparable. The Rodale Institute out in Pennsylvania, they've got some long-term field research and trials where they've shown that there's really comparable yields between organic and their non-organic counterparts. I think another important point is that experts that have really looked at the world hunger issue have found that the issues have to do with distribution, storage, and access, and it's not so much about inadequate yields. It's not that we're unable to produce enough food to feed the world. In fact, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations just held an international conference in Rome, Italy. This was last May, just a month ago. And this conference brought together representatives from 80 countries to discuss organic food's potential for improving global food security.
Sure, that makes sense to me, and that's very encouraging to hear.
Yeah.
You know, it also makes me think, as even though I asked the question, that, you know, what we eat, you know, having eating higher on the food chain, like beef instead of grains, impacts the availability of food around the planet too.
Uh-huh.
So organic beef is good, but organic produce might be better, isn't it?
Yeah, it could be.
Well, the doctors keep telling us to eat more fruits and
that's
vegetables anyway,
eat
right?
Eat your vegetables at home.
There are lots of good reasons to do that. So what percentage of the farms or the land that's in agriculture right now in the U.S. is organic versus not, and what are the trends there?
Our most recent estimates are that there's about 10,000 certified organic farms throughout the U.S. All 50 states have organic agriculture now.
And so 10,000 versus
total farms.
Total.
Yeah, well, those 10,000 farms are farming on about 5 million acres. To put this in perspective, those 5 million acres are only about 1% of the total crop land and pasture in the U.S.
Wow, you don't think about that many.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot, but it's still a very small part of the total food system. But it's been seeing incredible growth. Organic food sales have been increasing by 20% each year for the last 10 years.
That's like the fastest growing sector in the marketplace,
isn't it? It is, and that's why there's more and more interest. And in 2006 alone, organic food sales were $16.7 billion. To kind of talk about trends more locally, here in Oregon, from 2005 to 2006, the acreage of certified organic cropland and pasture increased by 30%. So by the end of 2006, we had 357 certified organic farms in Oregon farming on about 59,000 acres of pasture and cropland. And in 2007 already, Oregon Tilth has received applications from 50 new farms looking for organic certification. So it's really growing here in Oregon and throughout the U.S.
Wow, that's amazing. That's great growth.
Yeah.
That's great news. It's great for the birds and the bees and the and the fish and the stream and all of that.
Well, we want to bring it too.
Yeah, we want to bring it home to our viewers now. We want to talk about community-supported agriculture, which is a great way for your family to participate directly in the growing process. And if you're not familiar with it, a CSA, as they're called, community-supported agriculture, is a relationship between you and a farmer, where the farmer delivers or you pick up a certain amount of produce every week. There is no better way to get local organic, and you can't get any fresher than this. And so we have April Westfall out in the field with us, who's visited one such farm near Oregon City, and she's going to take us there to find out how it works.
Hello and welcome to Sustainable Today. I'm April Westfall and I'm here at the Birds and Bees Community Farm in Oregon City. And this is John and this is Bev, and they've been so kind as to invite us out here so that we can learn about community supported agriculture.
Usually when I'm explaining community supported agriculture, I use the metaphor of a magazine subscription. Because with a magazine subscription, you sign up ahead for a magazine, you send in your order form and everything, but you don't know what's going to be in the next issue of the magazine. Our customers sign up ahead, and they don't know from one week to another exactly what they're going to be getting, but they do know that they're going to be getting locally grown. Everything we offer is right from our farm, locally grown, absolutely fresh, picked the day of, vegetables and fruit.
You mentioned that this is in part or wholly a land trust.
There are many different kinds of land trusts, but ours is set up to preserve green space and also secondary missions to demonstrate sustainable agriculture and forestry.
Okay. So you don't actually own it?
We don't own it. You're correct. It's owned by a nonprofit corporation.
Which was set up about 30 years ago, so it's been here a while.
We have some say in it. Bev's on the board of directors. The real advantages, I think, come once the land trust has been established. Because instead of having to buy into a farm in order to do something like this, you're not making land payments. You're just leasing from the land trust. It's making it available, the land available for people to use, treating the land as community property.
Right. Uh-huh. And we become the stewards of caretakers for that land.
And of course, that doesn't mean that everybody comes in and wants to use your bathroom. You've got your private space. There's an understanding that in return for your stewardship, you get some privacy and you get some privileges. Mm-hmm. But the privilege you don't get is to subdivide it and
do what you want with it.
Yeah, right. Turn it into houses or something that the land trust organization doesn't want to have happen.
So what would you say is your mission here at Birds and Bees? What are you hoping to accomplish?
We want to model a small farm that's very sustainable and very community oriented, something that the neighborhood, the community can depend on.
Mm-hmm. Well, we would love to get a little tour of your farm and whatever you'd like to show us. That would be wonderful.
This is a juice apple here. That's one of the reasons why we're not thinning it. It makes a nice juice, but it's not a real good eating apple. Yeah. Over here we have a Satsuma plum tree. In back of it there's a Liberty apple tree, another Satsuma.
So how does this work? Do the customers actually get to, do they come and pick their own food? Do they help with the watering?
Pretty much they've hired us to do those things. We do have a certain amount of participation by the shareholders who come, and in exchange for a credit, they may work a few hours.
Hi, Jalene.
Hello, April.
Hi. So you are a customer here at the farm. If you wouldn't mind telling me how long you've been coming here and what keeps you coming back?
Several years ago I read an article in a magazine that's no longer available. It's Welcome Home, and they talked about CSAs. And so I got online, looked around for CSAs in the community, and found Birds and Bees and one out in Canby. And Birds and Bees had a waiting list, so we got on the waiting list, came out, took a look at the place, really loved it. It was kid-friendly. Kids could come out here and actually get to witness, participate in how farming happened, gardening, organic practices. We did the Canby one for 1 year, but this was something that was putting more gas into the community than we wanted. And then it opened up and we were here, and we've been here ever since. So I was pregnant with Rachel, so I know it was been 5.5 years. We keep coming back because my husband and I every year kind of make a little vote on what is important to us, and having the kids see that where our food is coming from, how we can contribute to it, it's organic, keeping it sustainable, it's just high up on our priority every year.
And you feel like this is good education for your kids?
It's excellent. We have other kids that think eggs come from the grocery store, and we know that eggs come from chickens. So,
yeah. So do you guys actually get involved with the gardening too?
We have. It keeps growing because the kids' attention gets a little bit better, but we come out every week and John gives us a duty and we come thin plums, we thin apples, we weed. It's good for the kids because if we teach them this generation, then what's going to happen to the next generation? And I think that one of the things my husband and I really looked at was that both sets of our grandparents were farmers or were involved in farming. Our parents were, at least started to live on farms and moved into the cities, and we had huge gardens. And as my husband and I were able to go back to the kind of the farming areas and take a look what it was, our kids can't do that. Our parents, their grandparents, were not able to go back and see the farm and see how animals lived. So we've lost that connection. And this way we can come back and they can at least understand what our heritage is, and they can understand the practices that will, you know, continue to the next generation.
We'll show you some of the things that we're growing in here.
The cows are coming out now.
So we have some beets here that we'll be going to our members, and I'll just gather a few here, get a sense of what they look like. We also have some carrots here, and these are small here, but carrots are very popular among our customers. It's something that parents can give to their kids and think this is nutritious for them. Fresh harvested like this, they're sweet. This was from a planting of cilantro, and you know, we didn't harvest everything, but we let a few of them go to seed because all these little flowers here are excellent food for beneficial insects that little wasps that will parasitize pests in the vegetables, and so we let a certain number of things, particularly things with small flowers, grow in amongst our vegetables because they offer habitat for the beneficials. And this is part of how we can succeed doing things organic and not having a lot of pest problems is because we're using we're working with nature rather than against what nature wants to do.
Mm-hmm. Busy all the time.
Can be busy all the time, but
you don't have to be social.
But
we're
not harvesting all the time. Yeah. That gives us time to plant and to weed, to water, and maybe catch our breath.
These are our compost bins, and this is where everything goes in to start with, and then we just pitchfork it over to the next one until at the very end, it's soil.
It's finished compost, ready to be used. Whatever we need, some rich material. This, by using compost as material, we're recycling everything, and we're avoiding having to buy. Well, it means we don't have to use synthetic fertilizers. Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned the farm is about, was it 67 acres?
The farm is the land trust is.
The land trust is 67 acres. Uh-huh.
And it's wooded.
Mostly wooded.
So the farm itself is just a small part of that.
And what percentage or how many acres is just the farm itself, would you say, roundabout?
We farm in total 9 acres. Uh-huh. Most of that is pasture and hay field and just a little over 2 acres is orchard and field crops. And out of those 2 acres, we feed about 27 families on a year-round basis. And we do that by a lot of succession planting.
Succession planting. What do you mean by that?
That means that when one crop is finished, we put another in its place.
Okay, year-round.
Year-round.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
These are beautiful. And thank you, John, for having us out to your farm and sharing all of your knowledge with us. It's
yeah.
Delightful. Well, thank you, Bev.
You too. It's fun having you out.
Thank you. Yeah. We'd love to come back.
Good.
Have a good evening.
And I'm April Westfall, bringing you the tools to be more sustainable today.
Well, that was beautiful produce. It kind of made me hungry. And I hope it was inspiring to our viewers who are watching. We'd like to share some additional tips that you can do to be more sustainable today in regards to food production. And so obviously we're going to start off with our list of action items with joining a CSA. You can sign up and get the produce sometimes delivered close to you, or you can pick it up at the local farm. We also want to encourage people to buy local and to buy organic. And if you're not sure if it's local and organic, ask your grocer. Sometimes if you don't see something available in your market, just asking the grocer will at least spark in that person your desire for the food and start creating the demand.
You know, I think that works in restaurants too, to keep reminding people, is this fish certified?
Right.
Where did this come from?
Is the produce organic? That's a good point. And then of course, as we were talking, we realized, you know, you can also grow your own. There's nothing safer or fresher than pulling something out of your backyard and putting it on your dinner table.
And as we were talking before the show, it's great for kids as well, because, you know, when they grow the food, they're more likely to eat those fruits and vegetables. I have some raspberries out front of my house, and I put a sign that says, please pick some, and the kids are coming all the time to pick stuff. So I just love
that. They think
they're
getting away with something.
I know. It's great. It's wonderful. Well, Marcia was mentioning local. I wanted to ask you a question. I'm hearing from people that while there's been this huge ramp up in interest in organic, right now what they're seeing is more of an emphasis on local, which sometimes means you have to buy something that's non-organic. So in your view, if you have to choose buying something that's organic or buying something that's local, if you can't do both, how does somebody figure that out?
That sounds like a tough choice.
Yeah, that's a good question. Of course, you know, the best case scenario is local and organic.
Yes.
But the benefit of local is, if it's not organic, oftentimes when you're in a local buying situation at a CSA or a farmer's market, you can have that conversation with the person that grew that food, and you can ask about it and find out, you know, about the issues that matter to you. So I think that, you know, I can't really give you an answer of if you have a choice, you know, choose local over organic, because, you know, what if the local dairy is a 3,000 dairy herd in a confinement feed operation?
Yeah.
I mean, that I can't just say local's always going to be better than organic, but local at least provides for the opportunity to ask those questions. I think where organic certification becomes the most valuable is when you get more extended, more further away from your food. You know, when you go to the grocery store, then that organic label, you at least know what kinds of practices went into the production of that food. And if your grocery is carrying local produce, that's a great way to help support your local economy. So I think they're both helpful ways to regionalize our food economies and reconnect with the food that we're eating.
The answer is both and.
Yeah.
I've really enjoyed the store that I shop at labels the produce. It says where it comes from.
Yeah.
And it's been interesting. It has influenced my decision. I still am buying apples, and I now have to recognize that if you buy an apple in June, it's coming from New Zealand or South America.
Right.
But it's interesting to see that. Mm-hmm. You know, helps me make a better decision, I think. Yeah.
I know one of the things that you thought people could do is vote for change through policy. So tell us about some of the resources that are available that might inform people about food policy.
Well, we've talked about voting for change with your pocketbook and with your dollars, but you know, it's important not to forget that we can also vote for change through policy. And one of the things that is a really growing phenomenon is the creation of these food policy councils. Portland, Multnomah County has a food policy council. What does food policy do? Well, you know, government gets involved in a lot of things, from transportation to energy, but food is hidden in plain sight. And in fact, food impacts all of those other things. That's right. And so food policy councils really look at how the food system in an area affects all the other systems in that area. And so you can look at a food policy council and you can learn a lot of things. You can make initiatives to make change in your community, like, you know, create more farmers markets and maybe change some laws so that smaller producers can add value with less of the hurdles that are really laws written for bigger scale food production, things of that nature. Yeah, and also a real interesting thing that food policy councils are doing is food mapping, looking at what kind of food is available in different areas. One of the things that this has revealed is that oftentimes in lower income neighborhoods, there aren't as many options for fresh food. There's just, those people don't have access to that. So what can you do with transportation to at least improve that access to fresh and healthier food? And it's only through these initiatives of food policy councils that you can do that. Another policy action that people can get involved in is at the federal level, there's this massive piece of legislation that's passed every 5 years. It's called the Farm Bill.
I'm not gonna read it.
No, it's well, you can learn a lot about it. There's a great book that just got published by Dan Imhoff. It's called Food Fight, and it's all about the Farm Bill, and it really should be called the Food Bill, because it sets the agricultural policy for the U.S. for the next 5 years. And in 2007, we're passing the next one of these. And so sustainable food advocates are really advocating for change by asking for more research dollars for organic and sustainable production. They're asking for cost share to help offset the certification costs. And they're also, there's farmers market support programs, there's nutrition programs, there's ways to get people that get food stamps have access to more fresh food through those food stamp programs. So there's a lot of things that can happen in policy that can really make a difference. And staying up on these things can be a challenge, but there are resources out there. There's the Sustainable Agriculture Coalition, and there's the Community Food Security Coalition. These groups really are actively involved in D.C. and lobbying for change and trying to make change in policy.
Oh, I'm glad someone out there is working on our behalf.
Yeah, I would think food security would be an important issue. I mean, if there's a disaster or something like that, I'd want to be sure that we could have enough food grown nearby that we could get it to us. So.
Yeah, that's right. And, decentralized and diversified food systems are definitely going to be more stable and more resilient when there's change, sudden, unexpected change.
Whether that be from climate change or an earthquake or whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So we also like to talk about what people can do at work, and it's important when you're at work to source organics when you're asking for catering, for example, or whatever. There are lots of opportunities there, and I know that there are the Office of Sustainable Development in the city of Portland has a list of green caterers, for example, so that's nice to have, and I know they buy local and organic. I think you also mentioned something about healthcare's got something going. We've got just about 30 seconds.
Tilth has partnered with the Oregon Center for Environmental Health on this project called Healthy Food and Healthcare, and it's really all about getting Portland area hospitals to really prioritize sourcing sustainable and local foods in their food services, and that can make a huge difference in the local market for those.
Well, they must buy
tons. That's right.
Tons.
Schools
might
is another great example.
Might make a little bit
example.
Of difference for the patients, too, I'm thinking.
That's right. Healthy
no
food is good health care. Yeah, absolutely.
No more Jell-O.
I have to censor that one out there.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Product placement there. Product misplacement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, that's really exciting. Well, we wanted to tell our guests about the next show that we have coming up that's tying into this. Our next show is going to be about hunger because, we want to bring in social issues into this sustainability conversation.
Good follow-on to this show.
Yeah, absolutely. So we'll have the Oregon Food Bank come on. We went out there and visited, and they do so many different things, nutrition training, and obviously they sponsor the Blues Festival that's going on right now. We also will feature the Kids Cafe, which is trying to get good food into the hands of low-income kids, and also Pacific Foods as well. So that'll be our next show.
Yeah. So we hope you will turn in. Thank you, Chris, for joining us.
Thanks
and
for having
remember
me.
That there are steps you can take to be sustainable today.
There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home. It's where I live. And many others live here too. The earth is our home. It's where we live. We can feel the power of the noonday sun, a blazing ball of fire up above, shining light and warmth enough for everyone, a gift to every nation from a star. A big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home, it's where I live. You and many others live here too.